the people who enslaved them. Any African American can expect that 19% of their ancestors were white men. So the enslavers might also be your relatives. This is a study in contrasts: shadow, light, black, white, joy, pain, victim, perpetrator. You will find ephemera, editorials, photographs, wedding announcements, and atrocities. Lynched uncles, your people as property in someone's will, deed, or mortgage guarantee. You will also find the living: third cousins once removed, fifth cousins straight up, and descendants of the family that forced your family into slavery. You will meet them on beaches, in dusty archives, in farmhouses, scratching at the past like it is a lotto game, and you are strokes away from a million more reasons to believe. For a time, you will cease to believe in or pray to God, and instead will pray to your ancestors, the enslaved ones, the women, because they are what you want to be: mother, creator, feminine, divine. They were raped, they were sold away, they kept on living, some even thrived. If you are going to look for your enslaved ancestors, you will have to reconsider the word lucky. In 1858, when Colonel W.R. Stewart, a wealthy Louisiana cotton broker, married Elizabeth Macaulay, a girl from a long line of North Carolina plantation owners, her family gave the couple a slave named Tempe Burton as a wedding gift. Elizabeth was sickly and couldn't have children, but Tempe could, and did, have six of them with her new master, the colonel. My great-grandmother, Josephine, born a decade after slavery ended, was their youngest child. On my 38th birthday, I found their picture on the internet. It was May 7, 2007, and with all those sevens, I'd like to tell you that I was feeling lucky. Tempe was in the middle of the photo. Her former masters, Elizabeth and Colonel, were sitting behind her. On either side of Tempe were two biracial-looking girls. The one on the left was curly-haired and creamy-skinned, like my dad and my daughters. It was eerie how this century-old photo of my ancestors mirrored the new family I'd created, lucky and unlucky number seven. In 7 days, God made the world. In 7 plagues, God could wipe it out. On the 7th of May, I was born. In my 7th year, I was raped. It's been said that it takes 7 years for every cell in your body to change. In the 7 years after finding the family photo, I crisscrossed the country, uncovering the stories of the people in it, and a breach began to mend in me. There's a name for this kind of pilgrimage. The Akan of Western Africa call it Sankofa, symbolized by a bird in flight with its head craned backward and an egg in its beak. Sankofa means to go back and get it, or it is not wrong to go back for that which you have forgotten.
So for those of you who haven't read the book yet, I think the prologue is an incredible kind of introduction to kind of set up this experience. And it's full of, as you mentioned, these joys and despair, right? And it kind of opens with this whole notion of this image of your ancestors, and it's clear that there's been some sexual violence that has taken place, and that in a way is how you've come into the world. And one of the things that really moved me about this book is how you intersect that history of your ancestors and your own kind of a relationship to sexual violence and sexual abuse and incest and even how it's appeared in your children's lives, right? And I wonder, you know, in the prologue you mentioned this idea of a breach began to mend, and I wonder, like, how can you even talk about writing and researching this, and what was that experience like in terms of like the healing process, that breaching? Do you feel like you've accomplished what was burning inside of you? Because I think throughout the book you talk about so many different therapies that you tried to kind of understand, you know, how to kind of move forward, and it didn't work. But this seems to offer some sort of hope. So I wonder if you can kind of speak to that.
to see Timpy live half her life enslaved and then go on to live the rest of her life, which was as long as she had been enslaved, as a free person.
Yeah.
That was just really moving and powerful to me, to learn about her, what seemed like deep devotion to church and religion. I mean, several people came to her funeral, several ministers came to her funeral when she died. They pointed out in the paper that they were white, you know, several white ministers, which I guess was unusual in Mississippi at that time. So that really spoke to me that she had a deep spiritual life that also was recognized and acknowledged in her community. And so as far as how that affected me was, you know, I don't know, it seems kind of trite, but truly, like, if she could endure the, you know, real, really worst subjugation where you are not your own, you know, and come out of that and create a life through autonomy, her own ideas about things. It just gave me a lot of hope for myself. And I think there's also something in it that, and I think this happens whenever you go to any kind of group, you know, that of people who have been through the same thing you have, and you realize, oh my God, I'm not alone. And then somehow your pain is like halved, you know? It's like, okay, and together we, you know, and it sounds trite, but it's really true. Like the thing that I was trying to do on my own, I couldn't do on my own, but then knowing that there were all these people also trying to do the same thing gave me a lot of strength. So it's not that the other modalities I tried weren't working, that's not it. I just think that they all had their place, but it was the culmination of everything with this final last remedy, I'll put it like that, of reclaiming my ancestor's story. That was like, all right, you're good. Like, you know, yes, the bone was broken, but it's mending.
Yeah, okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
And so while reading this, I was struck by how many really awesome contemporary memoirs that it's in conversation with right now. So I was immediately struck by how it reminded me of Roxane Gay's Hunger, how it reminded me of Natasha Tressaway's The Memorial Drive, Nadia Olsu's Aftershocks, and these are women that I'm speaking to, but also thinking about Kiese Lehmann's book and Heavy, thinking about sexual violence and how we respond to those things and how it shapes, you know, and shows up in our lives. And I was really struck by how your book seems to kind of be speaking to those but doing something different and almost, in a way, compelling people to have this conversation more. And I wonder if you can kind of talk about that. Like, how is that a driving force of this, right? This seems to be a singular quest, but also this collective kind of thing that you want to kind of enter into to the dialogue.
Absolutely. Well, first of all, to be mentioned with any of those writers is like, you know, I'm beaming over here, so thank you. I really appreciate that. And that is absolutely my goal and hope. I do feel like sexual violence against Black women in particular is a particular legacy of slavery. And I do feel like it's still mostly the victim's burden to carry. So I do want people to more often talk about their experiences and acknowledge that it really is, it's like a crisis. So yeah, it isn't, of course it is my journey, but I am writing it with an awareness that there are many, many Black women who are experiencing the same thing. That definitely was on the whole of mine.
That was one of your principal goals. And that comes through really, really clearly and very powerfully. You know, I felt in a way taken aback to kind of say, where's my place in this? And like, how do I fit into this conversation? is how you treat everyone kind of with some fairness. Like, I think even you wanted to kind of hate some people more. You wanted to kind of, you know, not like this person. You actually found yourself, you know, in these really unique kind of human spaces. I wonder if you can kind of talk about some of those relationships with people and characters that you came across.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, obviously, you know, the character that I came across that I most loved was Tempe Bourbon, my enslaved great-grandmother. And then her daughter, Josephine, who it turns out, I'll just tell you, liked to write to the newspaper. And so that was a shock and a particular joy, being that, you know, I went on to be a newspaper reporter. So that was amazing. And then, you know, I'm going to talk about my third great-grandfather, William R. Stewart. So this is not the colonel, but his father. And he is one of those characters that I actually wanted him to be a totally good guy. I found his, he had family papers that he had left, and they were archived in a university in Mississippi. And as I read through them, you know, there were things about him that I identified with. He was on a spiritual quest. He changed religions from the religion that he had been born into. I did that too. He seemed to be continuing to search, you know, for some connection authentically, spiritually, that felt right for him, that was putting him in opposition with his longtime minister, you know. I get that, you know. I left my parents' church, and it was a big deal to do that. A perfectly wonderful church, but I knew it wasn't right for me. So reading his, you know, his letters, I was sort of waiting for him to say something about, and then I, you know, told my kids, don't ever get involved in slavery, and then I, you know what I mean, I was, and he turns out to be not that man, you know, and there, yeah, I did want to be very righteous and be like, you know, see another one like this, you know, but, you know, I could acknowledge the many facets of this person. This was someone who was trying to find some authenticity, and this was also someone who fell under the spell of money, you know, like a lot of people, and did the immoral thing because it was financially expedient. You know, he wanted to have more money.
Yeah.
Period. So that and the opposition of those two things, to see how much he was looking for a spiritual connection, and then to see also how important money was to him, was just like kind of mind-boggling.
Yeah.
So he was definitely one of those characters who fascinated me and irritated me, enraged me, you know. And I only get to know that much about him because he left documents. So that's another thing that was like very had me in opposition, you know, because I want the documents. I'm a journalist. I want to see, you know. And at the same time, my enslaved ancestors don't have that, you know. And so it leaves me in this constant like churn, you know, of I can have any kind of understanding of him and feeling about, you know, his quest because I know it because he documented it,
yeah.
You know. So it's like just keeps coming back to that circle.
So thank you for sharing for William C.
He's William R.
R. R. Stewart. Yeah, there's so many of the same names in the book.
There are.
Back. This was like reading a slave narrative in a good way, but like if you've read a slave narrative, you know that the authors were very meticulous in terms of documenting all of the names, and there's so many names here, so many Tempes.
There are
Tempes in here. So it's intense in terms of like thinking about reading it. But I want to go back to another character that you mentioned that it really upset me reading it, and the way you responded. I wanted to be like, Dion, come on, tell this guy off. Like, what's going on? Like, why did you let him off the hook? And obviously, that's a personal kind of subjective thing. But thinking about when you met your ancestors in Ocean Spring, you're like, oh yeah, we owned all this stuff, and you know, we in a way stole it from you. And then you were talking to one of the corporations, just not necessarily from us. And so I wonder if you can kind of talk about that experience of meeting your ancestors and them telling you directly that, yes, we are wealthy, yes, this was your money, yes, this was your property, but you don't have it anymore, and how you were able to navigate that.
We are linked through slavery, but not actually through blood. We're not biologically related. But when I met them and we began working together, it was so helpful in both ways. They were able to help me by pointing me to wills where my great great grandmother was documented bequeathed to somebody with her price. Which is painful, but also helpful, because it was helping me to get her story and more information about her. what Erwin's talking about is once we physically met. So a lot of our original go back and forth was just through email and communicating in that way. But then we had a chance and opportunity to meet in person. And when we met in person, I was actually looking forward to it because I was very grateful. I made so much progress with my research at that point, but also a little trepidatious, And when we did meet in person, this descendant did tell us about property that was quite lucrative, that was still in their family. That was difficult, obviously. I had no proof of the exact property being property that had been my great-great-grandfather's and therefore should have been ours. But, I didn't have any property, and they had a good life, They were well off. So it just seemed a little insensitive, if nothing else, And as far as, moving through that and why I didn't tell him off. A couple reasons. We were not in my hometown. We were in a town that I wasn't familiar with, where I hadn't seen any black people all day. I'm very aware of my safety, so I'm not about to be telling people off when I don't have my car. This was pre-Uber, so I wasn't just Ubering to get out of there. I had relied on him to take me where we were, and it was rural, so that wasn't happening. Also, I was just kind of stunned, too, and this is just part of my character. Anybody who knows me knows that I'm not quick on the draw, It takes me a good 4 days, I think, to sort of come to awareness of what even happened, and then by then something else has happened, we have to move on. So it's very rare that I'm able to actually have a comeback. I am not the comeback woman. I just never have a good one. And finally, I will also say that I think I was so stunned by something else that he had said earlier in the day that I also was just, there was so much has happened. He had told us about a lynching in our family that an older relative of his had confirmed had actually happened to one of Timpey's sons. So there was a lot of information to digest, and I just wasn't thinking about him, to be honest with you. I was thinking more about all of this information. But then, as time passed, I think more than anything, my work was to decide how to be in relationship with him, if at all. I think I was also very, very concerned about access to information. So this is my real dilemma. they had the records, and I didn't want to do anything to lose my access to those records. Now, other people would say, I had a cousin I was working with at this time, Monique, another one of the characters. She's one of the great living characters that I got to meet, another descendant of Tippi and Colonel Stewart's, who became my research partner, and she was just great. She was just like, yeah, I don't need to ever talk to him again. She was just kind of like done, and she didn't care if, never found anything else. But I just felt so invested to finding every single thing that there was to find about my enslaved ancestors. And if I had to, like, I don't know, not respond to that, then I would. I later did respond, and we later did kind of part ways. But what was good about that, by the time I got to that place, I realized that there were all these other avenues of searching that I hadn't really engaged with fully yet. So, you know, I just went my way, and it turned out it all worked out in the end. I was able to find what I needed to find about my great-great-grandmother.
Well, I definitely want to apologize for your temperance in that, in that way. And in a way, I think your book is a guide of sorts of how to kind of conduct this research, how to actually find your ancestors. I know in some ways throughout the book, you use this language as a rhetorical device if you want to go find your ancestors. But after a while, you start to kind of think about as a reader, like, well, maybe this could help me kind of find my ancestors. And thinking about that, one of my favorite lines in your book, it's a couple lines that really struck me that I was like, wow, I should probably kind of see if I can kind of deal with this. Can I handle this myself? So I'll just read it. It says, hell is other people, and other people are necessary for healing. It's just... It just is how it is. You know, hell is other people, and other people are necessary for healing. And I kept coming back to that, like, wow, okay, how do I deal with the hell of healing? And I bring this up because towards the end of the book, you face your childhood abuser, and you know, you seem to be conflicted in a way of why you did it and how it happened. I wonder if you can kind of talk about that in terms of this whole process, right? I mean, I think throughout this book is really about facing it in many ways, right? I wonder if you can kind of talk about like what that did for you and how you're still kind of working through those things.
Yeah, sure. So for me, I think what was most healing to that point in my journey with abuse in confronting him was that I was supported by my family in doing that. And I had been alone for so long in that, you know, in the violence I'd experienced. So I already felt like just them acknowledging that this had happened to me and that it was horrible and that they wanted to support me was kind of already I'd won, you know. Confronting him with the therapist, because that was kind of my requirement for being in conversation with him at all, I wouldn't really say that was actually very helpful. It was more just informative. I got information that would help me decide how I wanted to move forward, if at all, in that relationship. And the thing about, like recovering from that kind of abuse is like, it, you know, it's not a straight line, do you know? So what I was comfortable with in 1996, not really comfortable with now, you know, but I might have been in like 2000, you know. It's really not a straight line. So but I can say today I'm a lot clearer about my boundaries with that person and within the family. It's very difficult when it's a family member, you know, because everybody has their own experience with that person, you know, and my experience with that person can't really dictate, you know, how they feel about somebody, you know. So I think as I've just gotten older and continue to try to take care of myself, I've gotten clearer about what is okay for me and what works for me. But I continue to have a lot of questions too about like what I want to do moving forward, you know. There are all sorts of avenues available to me that weren't available to me. Now there's, I can't remember the name of it, the bill, but you know, you used to have a very short time frame to like actually like file a civil suit But so that's given me things to think about. Is that something that I want to do? I don't know. I'm still not sure, you know, because I don't want to kind of tear open.
Yeah.
However, there might be, it might be an even deeper healing, you know. I don't, it could be either one. So, yeah, so that's the latest thing that I'm working through.
Well, and
it's
there,
all good.
Yeah, the reason I asked that question, too, just to kind of be fair, just kind of give you guys the context, is that you're in that space. You end in this space of questioning and imploring the reader to kind of think about what happens to Black women's bodies, right? And I was really, really struck about, you know, the opening image, right, of your ancestor Tempe and then your own and then your daughter's image, and like, what does that really mean in terms of like working through these things? And I'll ask a couple more questions before we get to the audience. But I would reading this book, I learned so much in a way that, you know, I want to make sure that you hear this as a compliment, right? Because you think about reading a person's memoir, and you read their lives and at least the parts that they want to share, and you think that you're going to get into the things that are their obsessions, right? Things that they are interested in, and I came across so many moving moments that I wanted to kind of, you know, take a step back and kind of pull back and let you guys kind of engage with. But one of those moments was a place that you returned to with your kids. You studied abroad in Brazil, and you tell this incredible story about seeing your first Confederate monument in Brazil. I wonder if you could kind of tell us a little bit about that experience and also about your healing process. You were dealing with some addiction then, and coming out of that space, you found something in Brazil that was able to help you kind of deal with that addiction.
So I think I was starting my addiction. I went to Brazil when I was 16 as an exchange student. And so, you know, if you get into Rotary, they just send you somewhere. So they sent me to this town called Santa Bárbara do Oeste. And lo and behold, it was actually founded by Confederates. I had no idea. So I end up in the like last Confederate colony in Brazil. And I mean, it was important for many ways. First of all, who would have thunk it, right? I was shocked. And there was a monument there that's still there. And that made me really, it was that monument that was there that we American exchange students were asked to go and talk about. You know, we participated in their first public party, Festa, Confederada, for the families of the descendants of those Confederates. They had, up until that point, always had like a private party, but this was the first one they opened to the public. And we American exchange students were invited to go and talk about being American or whatever. And honestly, it was that time when I realized, oh my God, I don't know anything really about like my American history of slavery. It was like, what do I know? I don't know anything. So it was important in that way that I think it really struck me just how little I did know about the Civil War. And it also kind of struck me because I guess I hadn't really thought about slavery outside of the United States, so it also really just brought that into my awareness. I mean, the Portuguese were, I think, like the biggest importers of slaves, and Brazil was the place that probably had the most enslaved people brought to there. So it just opened my eyes in a way that I wasn't ready to deal with. And there was a lot of things that I was also, you know, kind of suppressing the sexual trauma I had experienced. That was definitely where I learned to drink and began drinking. And so it's also the way that I learned one kind of healing, you know, healing practice that I did for a while. I don't do it anymore, but many years years later, when I was reconnecting to this history, I started playing capoeira, which is a Brazilian dance and martial art that was created by slaves. So it was very beautiful and healing for me to do that, and I did it, practiced that with my, we say play, I played capoeira with my kids as well, and even got a chance to return to Brazil with them. So, yeah, so one of the many, many things that I was happy to reclaim and has been a balm to me. Thanks for asking about that.
So we're gonna move into the Q&A. I wanna ask a really quick question, though. I know they're gonna beat me up here. The cover is really incredible. Like, I want you to kind of talk about the cover of this book, because these are your ancestors.
Yeah.
And, like,
and my kids, too.
Yeah, and your kids. And, like, how did you come about getting the publisher to do this? Like, this is it. I'm walking away from the table. If you don't have my ancestors, my children on the cover, could you talk about it a little bit?
So, all props go to Bold Type, because this was the designer that they hired. This, he came up with. And I was like, yes, that's great.
That's what
perfect.
I was thinking.
Yeah, it's what I was never thinking, and it's the perfect thing. So up here is my great-great-grandmother, Tempe Burton. This is my great-great-grandfather, Colonel W.R. Stewart. And these pictures are taken from that picture I was talking to you about that I found on the internet. This is my, I guess, my great-grand-uncle, Adrian. This is my grandfather, Martin. He looks like a little girl, but it is actually him. I think that was kind of a tradition, actually, to dress little boys in dresses. This, I believe, is my great-grandmother Josephine. The girls in the picture were unidentified, but she looks so much like my dad and my daughter that I just think it's her. This is my grandmother Lily Mae's house in New Orleans that we no longer have. It got really damaged in Hurricane Katrina, and then further damaged in a fire. And this is my grandma Lily Mae, and that's my beautiful daughter Devin. I mean, I'm sorry. Oops, never tell her that I call her sister Desiree. And then inside is Devaney and me. And then I think my dad's on the back. He gets a picture by himself. Oh, there he is. And there's my dad when he was in the Air Force. Thank you for letting me do that.
No, I think it's important. I think the work that you went, that you put into this book in terms of the research is very evident. It's dense in all the right ways, I think, and I think you should definitely be proud of your achievement.
Thank you. Thank you so much for taking the time to talk to me about it. I really appreciate it. Thank you.
All right. Question.
Hi.
Hi.
I have not read your book yet, but Irv was telling me how great it is, and we were talking about it on the ride up here, actually. And I have a question about your book seems to be one of revelation, and as Black people, we, particularly descendants of enslaved people in this country, we have this tradition of silence around a lot of things. How do you contend with, in a book of Revelation, dealing with the unspeakable?
I speak it. That's really what I did. And I did try to acknowledge how difficult it is. You know, my grandfather talking about his grandmother as a worker on this plantation, because I don't know this for sure, but I sense it was too painful to talk about the fact that she was enslaved by his grandfather, you know, to acknowledge when I asked him, are you white, because his skin was so, you know, fair, to the pain of having to acknowledge that he looks like that because the man who enslaved his grandmother was also his grandfather. So, yeah, my way of contending with it is to speak it, to take the shame that is somehow passed on to the victim and give it back, and encourage other people, lay that down, because that's not yours, you know, and hopefully ask us all to recognize this is our national story, and God willing, we can go forward together. We can look at it, you know, and honor it, and
so many of us have been through similar things. You spoke to your abuser is in your family, you still see that person. Your family supported you in speaking to him, and you're contemplating taking this to a court of law, and you wrote about it in your book. How does that all fit together? How is the family still whole? And how were you, how did you, you must have been terribly afraid that this could break up the family.
Absolutely. I mean, I didn't say anything for years because I was so sure just to say it would kill my parents, seriously. And I think that's kind of typical. And so how does the family go forward? You know, I guess as far as I'm concerned, I have my particular relationships with all the members of my family, and that's, I focus on that, and I don't get involved with their relationships with my abuser, and I make decisions about whether I'm going to see them, you know, if he's around or not, and I've been honest with my family, the family I created, to keep them safe, you know. It's all really painful, you know, because it's not one and done. You know what I mean? Like, I don't get to say this once, and that's it, and we move on. But it's also very empowering for me to, you know, just be honest about this, and empower myself to just to continue to tell the truth. I don't know what they all do. I have no idea, you know. I'm sure a variety of different things, ranging from try to forget it to when I'm around, try and be as mindful as they can. Yeah, thank you.
Can I squeeze in one more? If no one else has one? So one thing that question kind of brought up, and I wanted to kind of get to this as well, throughout these pages, many times you're talking about the complexities of mixed race unions, including your own. And I wonder, like, I really appreciated that in terms of thinking about, like, what does race mean to us, and like, how can I love, you know, my husband and also kind of have this animus for all these other people, you know, who enslaved us. Like, I wonder if you could kind of talk or speak through that or talk about that.
Yeah, something that has been coming up for me a lot that I think I was trying to sort of grapple with in these pages is how I have all these emotions for pretty much anybody I'm intimate with, you know? The complexity of trying to have really honest, intimate relationships on the one hand with someone who I choose, you know, who I consensually engage with, like my husband, and then the fact that I am here also because of something that was non-consensual, but then also the ambiguity of my great-grandmother having another child with my, or maybe forcibly, I don't know,
yeah.
You know, so there's so much ambiguity, and it did make me think a lot, and I still think a lot about just the what I find is really my struggle, which is to have sort of equal, equitable, intimate relationships, whether it's like a sexual one or even just with friendships. I find that I struggle to not dominate or be dominated, you know. I just find that being both in my power and allowing that person to be in their power is like is a challenge. It's a challenge for me. And it is, particularly when it's with men, because I just was socialized in a certain way, and it always seems like there's this power dance. So
no, I appreciate it that you put this on these pages, that you're still dealing with that.
Sexual violence against black women today is in some ways slave owners, they owned these people. Today, it's a kind of relationship. And it's just sexual violence against black women. So I'm curious.
What I mean.
You have one related to
that. Oh. So I just feel like, you know, that a part of the way that this country was built was on the rape of black women. If you think about that, you know, a child born to a black woman, then if she was enslaved, became a slave. So, and there were enslavers who did, you know, have children with their slaves and then sold them. Yeah, I do think that the way that black women are stereotyped, and black men, frankly, is a legacy of slavery. I do believe that. I think, yeah, that was the thing that I was exploring there. And